previously on Life.
Health is clearly a precondition for any effort to make a development.
You cannot change social attitudes in 1 or 2 years. It takes really long time.
By setting the targets of the Millennium Development Goals, we are creating an agenda of things to achieve.
This is the story of the valleys of South Wales. Once thriving coal mining towns and villages, the communities who live here now are steeped in poverty and sickness.
Today, Wales has a reputation for being the sick man of Europe. We have illness problems which look like developing country problems, because these are the problems of poverty, poor diet, substandard housing. These are the problems of development.
The social problems left behind by a redundant coal industry are mirrored in the landscape, which is scarred with reminders of the past. This edition of Life investigates why communities here have become some of the most deprived and unhealthy in Western Europe, and meets a man with a mission to change them.
If you live in Wales, there's a greater chance of you dying younger than in any other part of Europe. And that can't be right.
Along with health promotion and wealth creation, Life finds out how the valleys of South Wales are becoming green once again. At the turn of the 19th century, Welsh coal powered large parts of the world. At a time when ships, locomotives, and industry ran on coal, South Wales produced a third of total world coal exports. But the miners and their families would suffer for their contribution to the British economy. One of the four countries in the United Kingdom, Wales today is struggling to keep up with its better off and healthier neighbours.
We shouldn't see developed countries as having triumphed over all the problems of development. These are the pockets of underdeveloped country in a developed nation.
Lindsay Whittle comes from a long line of miners. Today, he is leader of Caerphilly Borough Council. In his lifetime, he's witnessed the decay and dereliction that came with the closure of the collieries.
When coal was king in these valleys, at its peak, the coal industry employed 40,000 men and boys. Now it employs none. Many of those men and boys were to lose their lives and were to lose their health. Behind me stands the winding gear, a proud and silent monument and tribute to those hard-working men and boys and the communities that they served.
Like thousands of former miners across the valleys, Willie Miles has been breathing through an oxygen mask for almost 20 years. He's lost the use of one lung altogether and can only use a third of the other.
If you've got this, nobody can help you. You've got to put up with it and enjoy life as you can. I've had a good life, can't grin about that.
Willie's son Ron also used to work in the mines.
When you're talking to him and he's struggling to breathe, you find that you're breathing for him. When you think back to what he used to be and what he is now, he used to be very active, and of course he's non-active now. He can't even get out of the house, really, unless he's carried out, you know, because Even to go to the toilet, he's sitting down with his mask on, with his oxygen on for about 20 minutes, and he can't even speak, you know, until he gets his breath back. And obviously worse it's going to get, but it's not a very nice way of living, really.
But it's not just the Welsh mine workers who suffered. Whole communities lived in the shadow of danger. In 1966, a tragedy occurred that would change the course of Welsh history.
Disaster struck suddenly this morning at the small Welsh coal mining village of Aberfan. Soon after nine, a mountain of slag piled high behind the village and loosened by 2 days of rain, slumped and spilled across Aberfan. The village primary school, in which 200 children had just begun their first lesson of the day, was smashed and half buried under rubble.
October the 21st, 1966 was possibly the darkest day in Welsh history. Every town and village had a slag heap above it, and this disaster could have happened anywhere. And that shock was felt not only by this village, but by Wales and the world. You know, it was the darkest day ever, in my opinion.
Up until that point, whenever the environment had come into conflict with the economy, the environment had always come off second best. But October 1966 is the point, in my view, when many people in Wales first began to reassess their attitude to the environment, and they realised there were enormous human costs attached to environmental indifference.
The government of the day took the controversial decision to use some of the donations the public had made to clean up other coal tips across the country, a decision that had a profound effect on the young Lindsay Whittle. It was Aberfan that prompted him to go into politics.
The government, in my opinion, had a duty to take the tips away. This community has paid the ultimate price, and to take money from the fund was nothing short of absolute robbery, in my opinion, and was a despicable act. And I then decided to become a political person because I felt that decisions could have been made in Wales much better than that.
Over the next 20 years, the mining industry went into terminal decline. As technology changed, oil and gas started to replace coal, and pits were closed. Between 1960 and 1980, over 150 collieries were shut down, and 70,000 miners lost their jobs. The 1984 miners' strike was a pivotal showdown between the UK government and the unions, and signalled the end of an era for the coal communities of South Wales.
Many, if not most, of those towns and villages, the whole economic raison d'etre was coal mining, and once the mining industry went, so did the economic base for those communities. The combination of industrial disease together with poverty and unemployment has meant that we have some of the worst health indicators for the whole of Western Europe in terms of chronic illness, disability, heart disease, lung diseases, as well as high levels of mental illness, depression and anxiety.
Terry Jones is a former miner, now classified as long-term unemployed. In this area, one in three adults of working age are considered economically inactive.
When you was working in the mines, you know, you go home from work, first thing you do is, after work, you call in to your local club or pub. It was like spring, you know, you had that up and go feeling, like, you know, everything was great. You could go in and say, well, you're going to have a pint, get so-and-so a pint. And then, you know, them times are good to me. But when you can't do it and you're sat there and you're sitting back, you think, oh, I can't afford to do that. I can't afford to do this. It's obvious to take its toll on him.
With all the job losses of the 60s and the 70s, many people lost the will to work. And all they had to do was perhaps drink or smoke. So the population has, naturally is the wrong word, but it has unnaturally developed an unhealthy attitude to itself.
18% of people living in the South Wales valleys report long-term sickness. This is more than double the UK average. One in four people here suffer from respiratory problems, and cancer rates are among the highest in Western Europe. Health professionals put these extraordinary statistics down to lifestyle and culture.
Smoking is a huge problem. The main diseases we see are chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, asthma, and lung cancer, all of which have a legacy related to smoking and poor diet and poor lifestyle. It's called the Valley lifestyle.
We are still the sick man of Europe, and the sick woman of Europe, by the way, but for reasons which are not to do with coal. Nor is it just poverty. And this is also important because there are equally poor regions in the European Union which don't have our illness figures. So it's not poverty, it's culture plus poverty. And those are the reasons for our illness figures today, in my view.
Drug use is also a big problem in the Valleys. Mark Saunders was addicted to heroin for 10 years and has been to prison twice.
At the moment, heroin is such a big culture in the valleys. It's just heroin everywhere. It's the boredom of the actual valleys. There's nothing for children. Heroin's time at the moment. It's in fashion. It's really strange. In the valleys, it seems as if it's in fashion. It's come from London, the culture of London, where it was like cocaine and heroin, and it's slipped down into the valleys now.
There are an estimated 10,000 drug addicts in Wales. Mark is now on a court order to attend a group called Make a Change. It costs £4,000 to £5,000 per year per patient to fund community-based treatment.
It's basically just getting things off your chest, and if you've got any problems, to get them off your chest instead of keeping them bottled up inside. Because a lot of people relapse through issues which they just can't talk about.
It's this culture Lindsay Whittle is fighting to change. Mortality rates here in the valleys are the highest in Wales. Lindsay's passion for promoting a healthier way of life is driven by the fact that four of his school friends died before they reached 50.
They died far too young. One died through HIV/AIDS related illness, another through a heart attack, one had severe mental problems, and another through substance misuse. And I find that tragic, and I now regard one of my missions in life as a politician in this area to ensure that people live as healthily and as long as possible. These young people surely deserve a good chance in life.
The Young Mums Centre in Caerphilly is a support group for teenage mothers. Today, they're discussing health.
Do you think, you know, people are right to be worried about how things are, or...?
If you're meant to have cancer, you're meant to have cancer. If you're going to get it, no matter what you do, no matter what you take, what precautions you take to go up to it, if you're going to get something, you're going to get it.
So about the stuff you give children, do you think that's important from when they're tiny?
It should be, like, fun if you didn't junk and stuff, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, it should be, like, toddlers should have chocolate face covered in chocolate and chocolate apples. That's what kids are for. That's what they should be. Yeah, it wouldn't look right with a kid with bananas.
The UK has the highest teenage pregnancy rate in Western Europe. But in Caerphilly, the rate is 64% higher than the UK national average. Lisa Kemp has a 2-year-old daughter, Kia.
I called for Kia when I was 15. I was 16 when I had her. I had her on Boxing Day. And then I started coming down here then. And it helped me a lot. It kept me sane. But having Kia so young, I can't get a job, really, because she's not in school yet. And I haven't really got nobody to have her.
The young mums are now being encouraged to cook healthy food for their children as part of the council's health promotion drive.
Down here is they're promoting healthy eating now because so many people are going down to the fish shop, McDonald's, because it's a lot easier to go down there instead of cooking something healthy, or just go down to the fish shop and get some chips.
Unhealthy diets are thought to contribute to the rising incidence of diabetes, known to affect more than 93,000 people in Wales. For the first time ever, Wales is seeing type 2 diabetes in children, normally only seen in people over 40. Diabetes costs the National Health Service in Wales £55 million a year. Specialist nurse Sian Bodmin sees the patterns recurring.
It's very much a cultural thing. The culture of illness and disease will be within a family, and it's very difficult to break out of the cycle and to try and liberate yourself from that.
Lindsay Whittle chairs a local committee called the Health Alliance and is on his way to open a new healthy living centre.
And again! Walk back! Walk forward last time!
It's important that we educate ourselves. It's no good us drinking and smoking ourselves to death and taking no exercise. We've got to take a little bit of responsibility ourselves.
Reaching the health targets set by the International Millennium Development Goals applies as much to areas like South Wales as it does to developing countries.
Well, good luck to Pontlothian Healthy Living Centre. I wish you every success and I hope you live all long, happy and healthy lives. Thanks very much indeed.
Bye-bye.
If you link ill health to anything, you have to link it to education and full employment. But what you do need, without a shadow of a doubt, is an end to the poverty in the valleys. Good, well-paid jobs will help ensure that people live longer.
As one of the poorest regions in Europe, Wales receives substantial European Union aid in the form of structural funds. Areas deemed to be lagging behind qualify for Objective 1 money to promote development. £1.2 billion has been pumped into West Wales and the valleys since 2000, but there are now fears that new members of the EU will start to take priority over Wales.
Quite clearly, many of the Eastern European countries are abjectly poor, and they will also need European assistance. And it's clear that that's where the money will eventually go. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing. But I think the indications are that the plug will not be pulled in Wales, and it will not stop just like that. It will be a gradual withdrawal.
The advent of EU funds led to a flurry of new company startups, followed in turn by a rash of company failures.
There were so many factories came and went. They'd open up for, say, maybe 2 years and bang, gone. But, you know, at the end of the day, to me, that was wasted money. That's a very harsh way to play with people's lives.
The most important example, without a doubt, in the last 50 years of a problem with the company would be LG, Lucky Gold Star, as it used to be called, the Korean company, which was the biggest single foreign investment project in the history of the European Union. And it came to Newport in South Wales and never, ever delivered on the jobs promise.
If the company don't create the number of jobs or they close, then we will actually reclaim the grant. And that is exactly what I did with the Korean company LG. You know, I think we take a very business-like attitude that, you know, this is public money, we do expect value for money, and if the conditions are not fulfilled, then we will reclaim all or part of that money.
Another day, another speech. Lindsay is speaking at the opening of a new innovation and technology centre built on the site of an old mining engineering works.
Gone is the old industry. Now, we will never, ever forget our past. It's very, very important to us. But as you can see, ladies and gentlemen...
The new centre has been built with EU funding and is a joint venture between the Council and the Welsh Development Agency.
Well, these are good, sort of high-tech, high-powered, clean jobs, and that helps attract... No one wants to work, 2 miles underground. People would much prefer now, in today's modern society, to have a pleasant job like this, and we can keep our more talented youngsters instead of exporting them across the world.
Good jobs, jobs which pay UK economic rates, are good for Wales. The problem we have in many areas is that people don't have the confidence to go to those jobs, because at the present time they have a certain amount of confidence that if they remain disabled, then they're okay. If they give up their disability or choose to go for some of these jobs, then they're going to find that difficult. And therefore they may be thrown back again into economic problems. At least they can manage where they are.
Former miner Terry Jones disagrees.
You know, there is people out there who just genuinely want to work. because of their health, they can't.
Terry is still out of work. Though he's retrained as a railway trackman, he's having problems finding suitable work in South Wales.
Well, as you can see, I've gone right through the actual computer system, looking for a job in the vicinity, but no joy. Unsuccessful again, more or less.
Young mum Lisa has managed to find a job working on a mobile creche unit.
I don't want to be on income support all the time. Because I don't want to be like everybody else all day, the young mothers. And get out and do something with my life.
Mark's heroin group is now staging drama workshops in the community to help teenagers learn about the dangers of drug abuse.
I actually do like my life now. As before, I was very embarrassed of being a heroin addict. My family disowned me, which is understandable, as I brought a great deal of shame upon them, but it's like a second chance, and I'm really taking hold of it now, and I would never have got off it on my own. I've got a reason for living now.
At Willie Miles' house, the postman has brought some long-awaited news. Under the miners' compensation scheme, Willie has been awarded £28,000, and his solicitor, Mick Antonew, has come for a visit.
Okay. And our recommendation to you is that you should accept that sum. Okay, are you happy with that?
I'm happy with it. Look, I'd be happy with a bloody £100.
I know, but it's not £100, it's £28,000, and it's for you, really for you, for what you've suffered, and I suppose for what your family have suffered as well over the years.
He would be quite happy now to have that before he died, because many of his mates, they've already gone. At least he can see what's on paper, and he's got more than his mates had. So he'd be quite happy. He can give the family now at least a decent holiday out of it, which is better than, it's better than nothing.
With over 500,000 claims, the miners scheme is the largest compensation program in the world, costing the UK government an estimated £8 billion.
It doesn't make up for the terrible disabilities that many of them suffered, but in some way it is at long last a recognition of what the miners have been through, what they did actually suffer for, really being the engine house of the British economy for so many years.
Part of the regeneration funding pouring into South Wales is now going into creating new country parks, removing the last remnants of industry and re-landscaping the valleys.
The slag heaps are now being either removed or landscaped to ensure that it doesn't look the grim, black, ugly scar on the landscape that it always has. And we are greening the valleys now.
Wales has now become a world leader in land reclamation. We get visitations from all over the world, particularly from Eastern Europe, Central and Eastern European countries, who themselves have despoiled their own environment. That's the future for Wales. If Wales has a viable future, it's through sustainable development, making its environment pay more economic dividends, rather than degrading the environment and having to relive the costs of that through an Aberfan.
As the valleys struggle to throw off their image as Europe's sick relation, there are hopes that making the valleys green again will encourage the brightest of the next generation to stay in Wales.
The old mantra in Wales was you had to get out to get on. Wales' most valuable export for decades, like my parents back in the 1930s, was our talented young people. And for me as a minister, one of my lodestones or my basic principles is how can we create the opportunities so that our young people can exploit their potential and develop that potential here in Wales.
I mentioned the fact that my forefathers and foremothers suffered during the period. I mentioned the fact that my four friends who I was at school with have died very very young indeed. And I genuinely believe that I owe it to my forefathers, my foremothers, and my four friends to in fact ensure that our future generations have a better quality of life here in our country, because this is a wonderful country to live in, and it has a wonderful sense of community, wonderful people, and I hope that it will play its part in a modern world. Stop the world, we want to get on, you know.